Thank you. The final item of business is a Members' Business Debate on Motion 3646 in the name of Tess White on improving the disaster response to serious weather events. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I would ask those members who wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons now. I call on Tess White to open the debate. Up to 7 minutes, please, Ms. White.
Thank you. Deputy Presiding Officer, Storms Arwen, Barra, Malik and Corrie were so severe that they tragically resulted in loss of life. And I know the thoughts of us all are with the loved ones of those who died. These major storms had a shattering effect on communities, and especially rural communities across Scotland. The North East in particular experienced profound and prolonged hardship. Households and businesses lost power for several days and couldn't heat their homes or premises in the depths of winter. Their connectivity was compromised because road and rail infrastructure were damaged. Their communications were cut off because they could not charge electrical items. Following Malik and Corrie, the storm damage was so severe that Edsel was completely cut off by fallen trees. In Fetter Cairn, sheltered housing complex Queen Elizabeth Court was without power for 3 nights. In Stonehaven, residents didn't know where to go to access much-needed support. Such was the scale and length of the emergency that many of those affected became what the British Red Cross describes as newly vulnerable. By a certain point, everybody becomes vulnerable. I pay tribute to the extraordinary efforts of responders on the ground who operated in very difficult and complex conditions, whether that was repairing line faults to restore power supply or going door to door to provide welfare support. The voluntary and community sector was integral to the response, and every single volunteer deserves our recognition and thanks. And I hope that others will consider signing up too. Although there was a massive operation to facilitate recovery, it was painfully clear that more should have been done to build resilience and protect communities. As we look ahead to the future, the Scottish Government's Storm Arwen Review is a step in the right direction. The 6 overarching recommendations and 15 action points highlight areas of improvement, but I strongly believe it needs a delivery plan. It needs to have clear timescales for implementation before this coming winter. There also needs to be greater transparency around the resources available to local resilience partnerships to take these recommendations forwards. We know what the risks are without action, and those risks are simply too great if these recommendations are not implemented expeditiously. I've talked to constituents and businesses about how they were impacted by the storms, and I've held discussions with the British Red Cross and SSEN about the changes that urgently need to be implemented to better prepare people, communities and infrastructure for future extreme weather events. A key issue that emerged from these discussions was communication, both in terms of advising people what preventative measures to take to prepare for a red alert, and also what to do when the usual channels of communication are unavailable for prolonged periods. When the red alert was first issued for Storm Arwen, there was no signposted to the Ready Scotland website. It has advice for putting together an emergency kit, including wind-up radios and torches. But it appears that public awareness of this resource was and remains worryingly low. Equally, many people across the North East couldn't use conventional lines of communication to access vital updates about the developing situation, from which roads were closed and when to expect power to be restored, to where to access support locally from rest centres and welfare vans. Yes, I'll take an intervention.
Gillian Martin.
Very grateful to Tess White for taking an intervention. I agree with absolutely everything she's said so far. Would she agree with me that the local radio stations could have played a bigger role in getting that message out, given that a lot of households would have had battery-operated radios and maybe they could be playing more of a role in future? in getting those messages to people.
Tess White.
Thank you. Gillian Martin makes a very, very good point. I think the radios, radio stations, and in the 15 points of the six-point plan, I think it's very, very important that we do deliver on those targets, have specific, measurable, time-agreed plans so that they're all taken and effective before this winter comes. So thank you for that intervention. The British Red Cross has suggested that the Scottish Government should fund research with communities affected by the recent storms to understand how best to communicate in advance of and during emergencies. I do support this recommendation, and I ask the Deputy First Minister to address this point in closing. Earlier this week, I visited SSEN's headquarters in Perth, where I was briefed about lessons it has implemented following the storms. SSEN recognises, as well as the Scottish Government review and the interim reports from Ofgem and BEIS, that the estimated power supply restoration times during Storm Arwen were overly optimistic. This was deeply frustrating for customers trying to make informed choices about alternative arrangements, and many felt understandably let down and angry. I understand that SSEN has acted on this feedback and put a new process in place, as well as a £1 million Community Resilience Fund, and it's for the north of Scotland and was launched in February. There's also been feedback from responders that trying to identify and provide timely assistance to vulnerable people was delayed by the poor availability of information and lack of data sharing between organisations. There's much greater scope for cooperation between key stakeholders in this area. Deputy Presiding Officer, the scale of human endeavour to help the stranded and hungry will stay with us in the North East for a long time, as will the haunting images of the devastation in places like Kemnay, Fettercairn and Edsel, where forests were all but flattened. I was in Stonehaven after Malik and Corrie hit, and I saw firsthand how much the community rallied together, but also how much better the response at a structural and systemic level could and should have been. Ahead of the winter months, people right across Scotland need to know that lessons have been learned and change delivered. They cannot go through this again. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms White. And before I call the next speaker, who will be Gillian Martin, I would remind all those members who wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons now. Ms Martin, up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Really grateful to Tess White for giving us the opportunity to again talk about the implications of what we experienced with the storms that she's mentioned. I'm going to talk about Storm Arwen in particular. So 26th of November, I guess, was the high point of it. 19 full hours of 97 miles per hour winds, and then the subsequent 7 days of power and sometimes water outage for many households. And those households that were without power, as Tess White has rightly said, many of them didn't know the response measures that were getting put in place. And she rightly points to the communication methods that were used, and I think that there was certainly got the impression from quite a lot of people that I spoke to, including family members that were without power, that they just weren't aware of where the food trucks were or where they could go in terms of hubs to get maybe their mobile phone charged or maybe to go and get a signal. But that didn't mean that those things weren't happening, because there was an awful lot of response from volunteers, from Aberdeenshire Council, from the police and emergency services, and from third sector organisations, putting in a great deal of effort to make sure that people could get, you know, boiling water, could get a heat, whatever. So one of the things that I'm very clear on in terms of the response is that I think that households, in terms of their future resilience, should be given almost a kind of like indication of where those hubs are always going to be in the event of any emergency. So, for example, Tariff Swimming Pool. Tariff Swimming Pool opened its doors, the community centre and the swimming pool opened their doors so we could have showers and could have hot water. If they're willing, they should be the hub for Tariff. and I know that they have indicated that they would be. And one of our local councillors, and we were having resilience meetings, and as opposed to wash-up meetings with Aberdeenshire Council, with Jim Savage, the chief executive, and Murray Main, our retiring chief superintendent. And one of the councillors actually came up with an idea that it was a throwaway thing, but actually it was a really, really good idea. A fridge magnet. A fridge magnet for your area, where you put in your fridge, where you put whatever, and it has got a list of the places, the hub for your area. This is where to go in the event of an emergency, should you need it. So we're not having to rely on people finding out where the hubs are. They're just arranged. That's always the place that you're going to be. Another thing I want to mention is about vulnerable customers and SSEN in particular. I think the SSEN put out information, they had a vulnerable customer helpline. But actually, I know quite a few people, including some people that needed medical devices to work, that they would phone the helpline, but it actually didn't really do anything. What I think they need to do ahead of winter is I think they need to look at the people that actually registered for that helpline or the people that got in touch and actually start phoning around them and then finding out why they think that they are vulnerable, what it is that they need, so that they can have a list, an update list of who might need help should we have a situation like we had before. Let's hope that we don't. And another, in relation to SSEN as well, I think there's an awful lot of job of work that they have to do. And I recommend, I recognise everything that Tess White has said around funding and whatever. I really think they seriously need to look at their infrastructure. We've got power lines that, for example, trees around them aren't being cut back. And then, of course, as has been mentioned already by Tess White, those trees were falling down and taking down power lines as well. So I really think they have to do a significant investment in actually putting those power lines in subterranean locations. I know that's an expensive thing to do, but it's an awful lot better than having households without power. Presiding Officer, I don't know how much time I've got left because I can't see the clock, but I will bring it to a close. There's an awful lot more things. The radio thing I have already mentioned. I think that everyone should be recommended to have a battery-operated radio in general in their household. And I think the local radio stations have actually taken on board my criticism that they maybe could have done a lot more in terms of getting those messages out. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Martin, and apologies, I forgot to set the clock, but I think you were probably around 4 minutes. I would next like to call Alexander Burnett to be followed by Paul Sweeney. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr Burnett.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I start by thanking my colleague Tess White for securing this debate and giving us the opportunity to address the response to what were exceptional weather events. Now, it wasn't just the serious damage that storms Arwen, Malik and Corrie caused, but also that they occurred so soon after each other when communities were still trying to recover. Now, secondly, can I pay tribute to all those brave volunteers who supported their local communities, from checking on their neighbours to helping set up local hubs. The generosity of people during these times, as through the pandemic, has been inspiring. However, we should not need to rely so desperately on these individuals during emergencies. And there is a significant lack of resilience planning, including, for example, creating dedicated local hubs. And some of this work is still not completed from Storm Frank back in 2017, and a five-year delay that this government really should have been on top of. Now, it's obvious that when storms of this magnitude hit, telecommunications go down, and even at the best of times, my constituency doesn't have reliable broadband, and sharing information often does not reach those who are most vulnerable. And for those who have signal, face the issues of no means to charge their devices. But I should commend SSE at this point for some excellent communications. Greg Clark in their office deserves a special mention for tirelessly updating us and helping constituents who contacted us. And Aberdeenshire Council, who after a poor start, adapted and significantly improved. Sadly, Scottish Water's response was woeful. And I hope that given they fall under the Scottish Government, this will be something will be done to address this. Because during times of serious weather emergencies, we need to ensure that those who are vulnerable get help. And I sadly heard from people who were isolated and hadn't heard from anyone for days, including one constituent who was stuck in his wheelchair for 3 days because the hoist couldn't be powered. Stuck in a chair in front of a fire for that length of time is beyond most people's imagination and was certainly the most harrowing example I came across. Now, priority lists which have been mentioned were not being shared and consolidated, and visits from health and care partnership teams were not being communicated to others. So councils, energy networks, local resilience partnerships and the authorities must be able to collaborate in their emergency response. Now, there are also some actions post-events that need addressing, and compensation schemes should be improved. Electricity companies claiming that restoring the power, not even long enough to boil a kettle, counts as a reset of a compensation timetable, may obey the letter of the law, but certainly not the spirit. But another point around compensation is the inflexibility of the Belwyn scheme. The cost to Aberdeenshire Council was over £950,000, but they received nothing. So we'd like to see some more discretion for compensation, or at least some kind of sliding scale to support our local authorities. There are other smaller issues, such as the ability to get codes for defibrillators and the supply and reserve of generators for care homes, telephone masts and water pumping stations, and also the use of unique property reference numbers instead of postcodes, an area which particularly affects rural parts of Scotland. So we await the SNP Government's detailed plan of action, but from the answers I've received so far, I've low expectation. I'm told that the National Centre for Resilience will not undertake a review. So can I ask of what value is this body, based in Dumfries, to my constituents, if they won't review events like this? How exactly do they help communities? And what do they contribute to resilience planning, if it's not to address the points raised tonight? Because at the moment, it feels like every community council is having to reinvent the wheel with zero budget and only the briefest of guidance. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Burnett. I now call Paul Sweeney to be followed by Graham Day. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr. Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I thank Tess White for bringing this debate to the Chamber. I also want to declare an interest as a Director and Trustee of the Glasgow City Heritage Trust. I think I note the points made in the opening speech about the immediate recommendations of the report into Storm Arwen and how important they are, but I think we also need to take cognizance of some of the longer-term impacts and continuing effects of Storm Arwen as well, most notably in buildings that were damaged in that storm. There's a particularly egregious case in Glasgow, which I've been dealing with over the last few months. On the 29th of January, hundreds of residents in the Park Circus area of Glasgow were evacuated from their homes due to damage sustained at the historic Trinity Tower building due to Storm Malik. There have been long-term concerns about the structural integrity of that building, but motion sensors on the building were triggered by the storm, causing building control in Glasgow to immediately attend and evacuate not just the building and the owners, but also the surrounding streets. And there was a continuing period of impasse, which is continuing to this day, in fact, residents not able to get back into their homes, uncertainty and a dispute between the council, engineers, building control, as well as the owners, engineers, about the nature of the repairs, what's required. And actually, it shows that there is a lack of accountability and a lack of communication under emergency delegated powers when it comes to building safety and building control, which hasn't been addressed well enough in the context of these kind of disasters. Suddenly, residents can find themselves not just out of their homes, displaced for an indefinite period of time, but also these residents in particular are faced with bankruptcy because of the cost not only to repair the building, of which they're in dispute with the council about the nature of, but also to compensate the other residents who have been displaced out of their homes because of the exclusion zone. So that introduces a serious challenge that we need to think of in the longer term, and I don't think that this report has sufficiently addressed that matter, and this is a case study that we really need to take seriously. And indeed, there has been efforts in this Parliament and in the Government to address this in a longer term sense and in a wider sense, with the Built Environment Forum Scotland producing a series of recommendations in 2019 that would improve resilience of heritage buildings. And the aim was to establish long-term solutions that would aid, assist and compel owners of multiple ownership properties, particularly tenements, to maintain their buildings and have financial resilience in place to make up any shortfall that would require a sudden maintenance event like a storm hitting and unexpected damage. But the legislation is going to be so slow, Deputy Presiding Officer. The projected report that the Scottish Law Commission is proposing is going to take until 2026. This is a decade after, or nearly a decade after, the recommendations, or at least the exercise to investigate the recommendations, were set in place. The requirements are quite straightforward. A requirement for buildings to be inspected every 5 years, establishing compulsory owners' associations with sinking funds, and the establishment of building reserve funds. Now, there are complex policy and legal issues, notably around the interaction of proposed legislation with existing property titles and human rights concerns, But we need to move at a much faster pace, Deputy Presiding Officer. We're going to address the major strategic threat that extreme weather events pose to our built environment and the subsequent huge effects it has on people's lives when they're suddenly kicked out of their homes and lose that shelter and that basic fundamental right to property. So I think we need to look at what the Scottish Law Commission are saying. They're saying it's going to take until 2026. That is going to be way too slow. It's not fast enough. And we need to look at a way of increasing the pace. Sadly, it's an indictment on the level of importance, I think, that the government is placing on this issue, that we don't have enough rigour in approaching it. And we've seen all too clearly, as a result of Storm Arwen, the serious impact it can have. And the Trinity Tower case is just one egregious example. But with 76,000 pre-1920 tenements in Glasgow, with an estimated repair backlog of £3 billion, this is only a problem that's going to get worse and more acute as time goes on. So let's get ahead of the problem instead of dithering for another parliamentary term.
Thank you, Mr. Sweeney. I now call Graeme Day to be followed by Liam Kerr, and Liam Kerr will be the last speaker in the open debate. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr. Day.
Thank you, President Officer. I very much welcome the opportunity to explore the issues highlighted in Tess White's motion and therefore congratulate her on securing this debate. The lessons to be learned mantra was never more appropriate than in relation to the impacts of the storms which battered Scotland late last year and our preparedness for and response to these. And if I was asked for only one thing to focus on in that context, then it's communication. The scale and nature of Storm Arwen felt unprecedented. Our household and that of many of my constituents had not found itself without heating, lighting and telephone like that before. The lack of heating and lighting for the evening of November 26 into the next day was of considerable inconvenience. But my biggest personal challenge, though, being Transport Minister at the time, was having to drive around to find a phone signal in order to chair a transport system recovery meeting. But that's not the communication issue I want to home in on. Presiding Officer, we have as a society become utterly reliant on the phone and the internet to communicate and source information when neither is available. As we discovered in the immediate aftermath of Arwen, there's a problem. Being told either to phone a helpline or check a website for updates on when power might be restored or what practical supports available in your locality is of little real use when phones and internet are inaccessible. Do you have time, Presiding Officer?
Yes. Julie Martin.
Day, and it allows me to make the point that, of course, the fact that the BT were going to make all the lines fibre and that we've had significant interventions down in Westminster from our SNP group to make sure that BP rolls back on the digital voice fibre rollout, because we can't do without copper wiring if we're going to be in a situation like we were at the end of last year.
Graeme Day.
And, President, obviously, there's an example of the lessons that need to be taken on board from this. The disruption and the inconvenience suffered in Carnoustie, where I live, lasted hours, but in several smaller communities in Angus it went on for days. And the response to that, though ultimately extensive, was still inadequate, especially in those early stages. Not every smaller community was aware, for example, of the presence of food vans in nearby towns from which they could access free hot meals. And getting the kind of detailed level of information around anticipated supply restoration timetables was frankly a nightmare. I know, because as a local MSP, I found it virtually impossible to get that for constituents who were becoming increasingly frustrated at the lack of news and when their home would again be warm and lit and when cooking a meal would become an option once more. And that was problematic because, as a number have pointed out, had they been in possession of accurate information, they'd have made different choices. Gone to stay with friends or relatives rather than sitting tight and toughing it out, because the advice on how long they would have to do that for was either impossible to obtain or, understandably perhaps, wrong. But I know from subsequent discussions with SSEN that there is a recognition that the communication and information wasn't what it could have been, and that they are exploring how to get better at information and data sharing, which is obviously welcome. There are other questions to be answered, as Gillian Martin has noted, the dependability of some of the infrastructure for the power supply, and whether we have to look at the proximity of trees to lines. Those are just two examples. Some of the settlements that I represent, which are far from being remote, Presiding Officer, still don't understand why they were so badly hit by Storm Arwen and again impacted by Barra. But I do very much welcome the dialogue currently underway between SSEN, the local authority and some of the communities in my constituency about how we make them more resilient to such events. What they might need, to have available in the local village hall in order to provide a fully functional haven for residents if and when similar storms strike again in the future. So from a distinctly local perspective, lessons are being learned and solutions implemented. There were things we got right in Angus, and I acknowledge the role of the council and voluntary sector partners in that. But there were other responses that at very least need refining. I'm pleased that's happening. And I don't doubt, looking at the Scottish Government's review recommendations, that it's seeking to ensure nationally that we've learned from what happened last November and will be better prepared for future severe events. And I look forward to perhaps getting a flavour from the Deputy First Minister when he closes the debate on what the planned update on progress, which is due next month, might contain. Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Day. And I now call Liam Kerr. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I congratulate Tess White on securing this incredibly important debate this evening. The impact of these storms across Scotland, but especially in the North East, were devastating, and Tess and many members have given powerful testimony throughout this debate. I think it bears reiterating that what we saw on the ground were our local communities stepping up. So whether it was local businesses like Cafe 83 in Kemnay taking hot drinks and soup to a care home, or the Shire Council setting up welfare centres, delivering over 3,000 meals or carrying out 8,000 welfare checks. But I want to make two specific points today, because Tess White's motion flags that these weather events resulted in a loss of power for thousands of households, in some cases for a protracted period over a number of days. And she's right. The North East had over 10,000 homes left without power for at least 4 nights. Now, what we know is that the Scottish Government has a drive towards heat pumps as a solution, or one solution, to decarbonising homes. But these are powered by electricity, which means that during blackouts, as we saw in the North East, the only reliable source of heat for many were things like oil heaters and open fireplaces. So enough there, I had innumerable constituents contact me expressing their relief that they still had fires or oil heating during the outages. Now, the people of Scotland entirely understand the importance of reaching our net zero targets, but they cannot come at the expense of people's safety. And if the Scottish Government is going to persuade people in the North East to change their heat source, they're going to have to deal with the very real fears that people have of being left freezing in this situation. And secondly, I'd like to pick up Graham Day's important points. Many of my rural constituents told me of their terror at their communications being cut off. And with the increasing tendency away from landlines and the move to digital voice, people's mobiles are more important than ever. And Gillian Martin probably knows this, but I know will be concerned to know that BT actually say on their website, in the same way your broadband won't work during a power cut, so you won't be able to make or receive calls using digital voice. This includes 999 calls, which is terrifying for people. And members have rightly talked about helplines being set up, but after folk have run out of battery, they're in the dark about what's happening and how to get help. Now, several months ago, I asked the Scottish Government what planning and action it's taken to ensure that people who experience power cuts are able to contact the emergency services where their mobile battery has run out or the landline is internet-based. Now, in the response, having blamed the UK government, of course, the Scottish government went on to not answer the question. So we still don't know precisely what the Scottish government proposes for those who experience a power cut and are either dependent on mobile phones or the new digital voice. So this is absolutely something that needs to be addressed in the contingency planning, and the Scottish Government really needs to start taking responsibility for things like that happening in Scotland, not offering diversions to blaming the UK Government. Presiding Officer, Tess White is absolutely correct here. It is beyond time we started properly learning from these storms and implementing effective preparation and mitigation strategies, as a number of members have rightly suggested. We cannot hide behind statements that these storms are exceptional or unprecedented. We must do better. Local communities stepped up. It is beyond time that the Scottish Government does the same. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Kerr. And I now call on John Swinney, Deputy First Minister, to respond to the debate on behalf of the Scottish Government. Around 7 minutes, please, Deputy First Minister.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And let me begin by congratulating Tess White on securing this debate on an important subject which has consumed a large part of my energy and focus over the course of the winter months, given the gravity of storms Malik, Barra, Corey and Arwen, and the close succession in which they inflicted significant damage on our society. Tess White, in her contribution, made reference to some of the scenes, which were scenes, frankly, of staggering horror in the damage that was done in communities such as in Edsel, a village that I represented for many years. I was stunned by the images I saw of the damage to the natural environment around Edsel. And in a sense, the scale of the impact in such a community demonstrates just the severity, that one individual example, the severity of what was being experienced. And I think what that has to say to us is that we are in a different situation today in relation to the impact of severe weather incidents to those that we have experienced in the past, because generally in my lifetime I would say we have not seen weather incidents of this nature. The weather has been relatively, the climate has been relatively benign, but in recent years we are seeing a significant shift in that, the climatic conditions, which is why we have to take the actions that we have to take on net zero. Liam Kerr raises absolutely legitimate issues about some of the connections to some of the solutions that might be put in place, but I would point out to Liam Kerr that certainly if you're using an oil-fired central heating system, then you haven't got much chance of using that if the electricity is off as well, because it will be reliant on electricity to fire the boiler. So, of course, yes.
Liam Kerr.
I understand the point he's making, but what does the Deputy First Minister advise to those who do want to convert to something like a heat pump but are afraid to lose the backup of, let's say, an open fire?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, that's a slightly different issue to the one that I'm raising about power systems, because there are inherent vulnerabilities in all electricity-fired power systems, which is the point that I'm making, which we can't escape in this debate. Now, in addition to there is a necessity for us to respond to significant weather incidents, and Mr Sweeney raises the issue of Trinity Tower, which of course raises a different element of the impact of these significant and acute weather incidents, and some of the issues that he highlights in that case of course raise the questions about the resolution of different professional assessments that go into particular cases of that type, which are very difficult to legislate for and ultimately have to be the result of dialogue and engagement and resolution, where we hope there is goodwill to reach points of agreement. There are, of course, other wider issues that come out of this issue. One of the common issues that's come out has been the access to communications, and Graham Day made this point about the significant dependence that society now has on digital connectivity. And that is an important observation, and the power companies have to respond to that by having in place better sources of information that are advertising information in advance of incidents so that individuals are better prepared. I recently, of course, yes.
Thank you.
Tess White.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. The Storm Arwen review is welcome. There's a concern that it won't be acted upon by winter. So, Deputy First Minister, can you commit to having deliverable timescales in place before winter?
Deputy First Minister.
I would assure Tess White that that will be the case. You know, the government commenced Storm Arwen when the cleanup was still the review of Storm Arwen when the cleanup was still underway. We have published the outcomes of that. There was a slight delay because of the other storms that came along, but that's all been published. I think the delay was only about 10 to 14 days. We published those outcomes. We're working with the Scottish Resilience Partnership and also with local resilience partnerships, because although I hear Alexander Burnett putting everything at the door of the Scottish Government, which, you know, he's entitled to do so, but the Scottish Government cannot direct local resilience operations, and it would be folly to think that we should be able to do so. And indeed, Aberdeenshire Council would vigorously resist that, because they want to be delivering local resilience in their community, and there has to be a partnership approach, which I assure him is the case between the Scottish Resilience Partnership, which the government leads, and local resilience partnerships. We have to work closely with power companies on this. If Mr. Sweeney, forgive me for a moment, I'll just address this point. We have to work with power companies to make sure there's better knowledge and resilience available to individuals. One of the ventures I saw in my own constituency just the other week there was in the town of Aileth, where Scottish and Southern Energy had used a community awareness day to bring along some of their resilience kits, which they were making available, which included, the point that Gillian Martin raised, battery radios, which, you know, my household no longer has a battery radio. Well, we have now after I went to that information event. I'm grateful to SSE for that. But I think there'll be precious few households that have got battery radios nowadays. So in the absence, because of our dependence on digital technology, having access to means of communication of that type is really important for people to be able to hear some of the information that's available. I'll give way to Mr. Sweeney.
Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy President, for giving way. I just wanted to make the point that in partnership and dialogue, would the Deputy First Minister consider consulting with councils and other stakeholders being affected by building control, applying emergency powers where they declare a building to be dangerous? That has an incredibly onerous effect on residents, and I think that's little appreciated unless you're actually at the sharp end of that. In a democracy, it feels rather overwhelming, and I think there have been overzealous applications of it. There's no room for discretion, no room for assisting residents in recovering personal belongings, even professionally or medically vital equipment, etc. I think we need to have a more conciliatory and more cooperative approach going forward, and can that be incorporated into the study that the government is doing on this?
Well,
Deputy First Minister.
Mr. Sweeney makes a number of very serious and significant points, and I'm aware from some contacts that I have of just the disruption to people's lives that is still going on as a consequence of Trinity Tower. So let me take away those issues, and I will endeavour to ensure that the government uses its available channels to encourage dialogue to resolve some of these questions. There's one final point, Presiding Officer, that I want to raise, other than to reassure Parliament that the lessons that have been learned, the actions that are arising out of the review will be implemented, is to talk about some of the preventative interventions that we can make. And one of the strongest is in relation to the management of power lines around the country, the point that Gillian Martin made. When I visited part of Gillian Martin's constituency to look at the damage that was done by Storm Arwen, the proximity of forestry to power lines and the impact of the damage that was done in the community that I visited, it wasn't one tree that had to be removed to restore power to the particular settlement. It was about a dozen separate incidents that had to be resolved to secure power connections, which is why the restoration took so long. So the power companies have got to invest more heavily in removing forestry and foliage to protect power lines so that they're not damaged by such incidents. And of course, we will face incidents of this type given the severity of weather that we now experience. So I assure Parliament of the government's determination to work in partnership with local resilience partnerships to address these issues, and we will of course keep Parliament updated on the progress that is made in the months that lie ahead.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting.